business meeting, prison, this room, and I could say Buddha. And you wouldn't believe that. But there's something that will get you kicked out of a meeting for saying the word Jesus. And at the end of the day, I'm not trying to shove them down your throat. What I am trying to say is I want you to get to know him at a greater level and maybe have a little different perspective on him before you leave and understand that every human being, including me, in this room is not him. We are merely to follow his example. So, Lord, I thank you for another day above ground and out of prison. Not just the prison with walls or wires. I thank you for freeing me of the prison of my brain. Lord, I ask that you think through my mind and you speak through my vocal cords. Lord, I ask for forgiveness of all the things that are in me that are out of you. I receive the forgiveness. I thank you. I wish you wouldn't have had to been whipped for me. I wish you had to been ridiculed for me. And I ask forgiveness for the whipping I did through my actions. To my people that I love. The abuse that I caused verbally and emotionally through my actions. Lord, I receive your forgiveness. Please prevent me from ever doing that again. Because within my own strength, I'll go back to what I hate. Lord, have your way here this evening. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
So it's quiet in here. The word Jesus got your attention. And as I've been studying, more recently, a little more in depth about really who Jesus is, because a man that I respect that oversees a lot of ministry over in Thailand that we support financially told me that God was going to be revealing things to me on a deeper level. When someone prophesies to you and tells you something about you that has God in them, you should pay attention. But by someone telling you that God's got a life for you, that comes with a level of responsibility for you. So I began to really look at this in a deeper level. I've been teaching Tuesday nights for 14 consecutive years. I've never done something good for 14 years in my life. I'm successful at failing. It doesn't mean I'm a failure just because I fail, but I was a sabotage artist. I like taking shortcuts, but I come to find at 35 years of age, shortcuts are nothing but setbacks. You cannot buy the cliff notes on your recovery. You have to do the work. You can't just say you're working a program. It has to be seen that you're working a program. And if you're working a program, people will notice that you stop bleeding. When it comes to the Word of God, as I look at it, I don't just look at it. I just don't meditate on it. I stare at it. I stare at the Word of God just like I used to stare out the window high on cocaine. I stare at the Word of God, and the Word of God, which is living and active, as it says in Hebrews 4:12, is sharper than a double-edged sword. But there's something just as powerful as the Word of God, and that's called the Holy Spirit. I don't try to get too religious on you tonight. I'm trying to meet you where you're at, but I want to share the truth about who Jesus is. It says, when Jesus crossed over by the boat to the other side, what did Jesus have to cross over to get to you? What did the people have to cross over to save you? Some of you were on a recent 12-step call with me. I had to drive a long way before I jumped on an airplane to save your life. We need to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We need to understand that God will cross over things to save you. But in this case, he crossed over the lake to the other side. A large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Oftentimes, a large crowd gather around us and watch what we're going to do. There have been people wondering what we're going to do for many, many years. Now, no different than the crowd that's here tonight is no different than the crowd that was around Jesus back in his day. This crowd is filled with people that want to work the program, people that are skeptical, people that don't believe in God, people that are interested in what's being said in here, people that hate being with them. It's a room full of different people. No different than the people back in the day in this text. And Jesus is saying, a large crowd God was with him. Then one of the synagogue leaders, now I want to give a little theology, I don't typically do that on Tuesday nights, but you have to understand, the synagogue leader is the head of the Jewish religion in this particular synagogue. In these times, they're forbidden to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus is the Messiah. By this man doing what he's about to do, goes against everything he stands for. Sometimes you got to go against everything you stand for to get a healing. Sometimes you got to go against anything you ever believed, and you have to be honest with yourself, my beliefs and whatever it was didn't get me that far. So for this man, as a synagogue leader, I'm going to share with you about a blind man next week that got his sight back because a lot of us are walking around blind. In that text, it talks about these people that went to the synagogue, they believed who Jesus was and said publicly he was the Messiah, they get kicked out of church. That's the problem with church. They don't know how to deal with people like us. And at the end of the day, the synagogue leader named Jairus, which I can try to pronounce that information, I finally looked it up, but I think I'm saying it right. You gotta take risks in life to maybe speak out a spiritual word that you can't pronounce. And here's the same risk we need to take on the street, right? Cain saw Jesus, it says, and he fell to his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him. Anytime you plead with someone or something, you're recognizing that someone or something is more powerful than you. No different than when you go to court. You're pleading with the judge because your life is in the judge's hands. Now, I don't want to put my life back into a judge's hands anymore. Now, this man, being a religious leader, is pleading with Jesus. He says, my little daughter is dying. I have parents in the room. I'm a parent. You may be a parent. There's nothing more painful than when your child is dying. There's nothing more painful than my mom, and the only time she can sleep is when I'm in jail. That is no life for my mom to live, that she can only rest when I'm in jail. So the parents that are under the sound of my voice understand when you look at your son or daughter dying in your addiction, it's like you're dying. So this is that man, and he's pleading with Jesus, and he says, please come and put your hands on her so she will be healed and live. You see something happening here. That Jesus is this man's last resort. That this man leads the church. This man follows traditions. This man knows what religion is. One thing you need to know about Jesus, it's not about religion, it's about relationship. So this man has most likely tried everything to get his daughter better, and she's still in the same condition. So it says, Jesus went with him. When you ask Jesus to go with you. Now, in this case, it was in the tangible form. He was in front of them. But in the intangible form, in the spiritual form, when you stop your life, like Kate said, and slow down, and you ask Jesus to go with you, he will go with you. But make sure that Jesus isn't so far off that he's out of strength. Make sure that Jesus knows where you are. And now this is a man, so now he says, so Jesus went with him, a large crowd followed and pressed around him. That Jesus was willing to cross over the lake to the other side. Jesus was willing to say the full without compromising the truth. This man, who can't even really publicly acknowledge Jesus as the Messiah, now has come to the end of his rope. And he's willing to even, for lack of better words, put his job on the line with the church to ask Jesus for a healing. Maybe tonight you can come to the realization that Jesus may be your last resort. Maybe you have tried everything but him to stop using, yet you continue to use. What are you willing to put on the line like Jairus did in order to ask for a healing? I talked to my friend who I checked on the phone today, and I told him to shut up. He told me the first time in his life he can remember, he drove in town from the loop last night. He told him, Jesus has removed my desire for you. Some of you haven't had that happen yet. It's a struggle. I still think about it. I agree with it now, but the desire is gone. Jesus can do that. See, you have to understand that this man, he's tried everything. But this isn't the only story here. It says in verse 24, but it's not the only woman. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. So now you've got a similarity. You've got a young girl whose dad asked Jesus to come lay hands, pleading with Jesus. By pleading, you acknowledge the power in the person that you're pleading with. And now we ask Jesus to go lay hands because he believes that there was something in Jesus, there was a power in Jesus by laying hands on this little girl, she was getting healing. But now the text changes. So when Jesus was walking in the crowd that was pressing against him, so the next question I have for you is, what are you willing to press through to get to Jesus? And it's not just people, it's not just consequences. What are you willing to get through emotionally? But now there's another woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. So we got a 12-year-old girl whose dad is asking, will you come lay hands on her to heal her? And now you got a woman that's just in the crowd. Just part of the crowd. You ever wonder that at one time in your party group, you were just part of the crowd and somehow you ended up a junkie? At one point in the crowd, you didn't even want to be there. I mean, it's something when a guy like me is going to get cut off by a dope dealer. When you get cut off by a dope dealer, you got a problem. Because it's your money that funds the dope dealer's lifestyle. So the dope dealer's got to cut off. So now here's this woman that has been subject to bleeding for 12 years. When I look at the word subject, and I ask you, if you're going to school, what subjects are you studying? You're going to name your subjects. This woman wasn't known by her name. She was known by her bleeding. You're not even known by your name anymore. You're just known as junkie. You're just known as terrible father. Terrible mother, terrible sister, terrible brother. You're an outcast. You don't even call you by name anymore. There he comes. There she comes. No different than this woman who is known by the issue of blood. She's not even known by her name. She's not even known by her lifestyle. She's known by her issue. Tonight, I'm telling you, you've got to change by what you're known as. Right now, you may be known as, that's my daughter, she's a drug addict. Joe Gentle. You're known by your issue, and your issue is you. It's you. It ain't them. It ain't him. It ain't her. It ain't old girl. It ain't old boy. It isn't Judge Smith. It isn't Pro Officer Tim. It's you. It's not your actions. It's not the banker that denied your loan. It's not the cop that pulled you over from your 12 PWI. It's you. Say it's me.
Hey.
It's me too. So now this is this woman that's subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered, check this out, this is profound to me. She had suffered a great deal under many doctors and spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. How much have you spent on treatment? And I spent hundreds of thousands of dollars and used government money just to go worse. So could it be that Jesus all along should have been my first resort? Why did he have to wait to be my last resort? And it says, when he heard about Jesus, how you're here tonight, you've heard about this healing. He came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, which is his cloak. She was willing to push through the crowd because she knew that Jesus had something that she needed. And she was willing to push through the crowd to get what she believed Jesus had. What are you willing to push through? Why are you wearing the push? Now, think about what God is. This is powerful. I don't know about you, but I love the word God. And in the not to live, because he thought, check this out, because he thought, if he just touched his clothes, I would heal. Sometimes you have to have a real serious conversation with yourself before you reach for Jesus. I can tell you to reach for Jesus. Your mom can tell you to reach for Jesus. People can try to blame you, Jesus, but unless you have a conversation with yourself like, I've tried this, I've tried that, I've spent this, I've been here, I've been there, I've been down, I've been up, I've been counseled, all the great things, don't get me wrong, I still need therapy. But it wasn't until I was really depressed through my issues, the crowd of my issues, and reached my hand up, to just touch his clothes. I had to tell myself, my God, if he can do it with this Jesus name, I can do it. Just tell me where he is. And I had to trust to recover my emotions, my fears, my anger, my unbelief, my cynicism, my regrets, my judgment. All the weak people that believe, they believe in a 40 million. But this woman knew she was healed. She was not on her hands, but knew she had an issue with blood. See, you have to understand this before we're on like, pray God to get what this revelation is getting laid down right now. He asked his disciples who touched me. He recognized the power went up. He just went on his way. He was all going. He knew who touched him. He knew what happened. He felt the power. You have to understand when some of your significant spiritual development goes before you and prays for you, the power that's in them extracts onto you. So when someone dares to help you, they're taking what they have and giving it to you. You just extracted something. So if you're not making up, build them up somehow by doing good. Now, check this out. This is powerful, and I am able to get to my whole message here, but this is profound because I believe you're getting a better understanding of who Jesus is. Because at the end of the day, we all believe in something, but now Jesus says, who touched me? He realized the power went up. And sometimes you have to understand this too. He didn't touch his body, he just touched his clothes. Okay? Why did she just touch his clothes? Because she was afraid of the law of religion that she was unclean. But sometimes you just got to touch something that's touching Jesus.
Yes.
Just don't touch a person that's in touch with Jesus. Just ride out of that brother or sister's coattail. And don't size them up like, oh, I think he's 99 days blind for that one person. You want people looking at it? You want those microscope glasses? That's not how Jesus is looking at us, but check out what it says. He asks them, who touched me? They say, no one will touch you. Look at all these people pressing around you. And when he said it, she came back to him. Check out what she said to Jesus. Then the woman, knowing what had happened, where's Brad? Stand up. You better know what happened today with you and Jesus. Jesus removed your desire to do cocaine. You better know it, and you better tell him, I know that's what you did. Let's get out of here. Jesus is now proving to the church a very important topic here.
Yes.
It's only Jesus that cleans the unclean. The unclean cannot make Jesus unclean. Now Jesus says, Jesus, check this out. She's trembling because she thinks, see, you're trembling because you think Jesus is mad at you. You're trembling because you think that he's given up on you. This woman is trembling because she knows in that society that she had been that did something wrong against what the church says to do. The church is not Jesus. If Jesus was in the church in the United States, like Jesus seems to be in the church in the United States, the United States wouldn't be in a situation that it's in. That Jesus can clean you up. Jesus can cleanse you. Jesus can make you right. Jesus can restore you. Jesus can make you whole. And Jesus will elevate you to be the leader in this country to set the captives free. Yeah. one time Jesus said, I don't know about you. All I know is your story, and it's my message. Let Jesus in to clean you. Let him in. I will stand up. I don't care if you don't believe in him. He's not as aggressive as me. But at the end of the day, this is like the message I've taught in 14 years. But here, the miracle is not that you stop breathing. That's a miracle. But in my opinion, it's not the miracle. Some of us have stopped breathing. And God has brought us out of something that our identity is still in. Why is your identity still in something that God got you out? Now the woman says, and Jesus says back to her, daughter, she's no longer the woman with the issue of blood. There's an identity change. Too many of you in me at one time are rolling around because I'm a failure. That's not who Jesus says you are. So now she's no longer known by her issue. She's known as a daughter.
Yes.
And Jesus says to her, will you touch me? Will you touch me? That ain't what stopped bleeding. It was the faith to push through the crowd to touch me.
Right.
It's not about the destination. It's what we pick up along the journey. Because when I started going through the crowd, it was my faith. You did it, yes. So the areas that we bleed over a broken heart. I got divorced papers 14 years ago. It broke my heart. Brought me to my knees. I lost everything. But you know what Jesus did? He bound up my wounds. My heart is no longer broken. Too many of us have had our hearts broken, and we don't go to Jesus, and we're still walking around with a broken heart. Another thing that happened to me, Psalm 23, bleeding over circumstances. When this journey started, several hundred thousand dollars in debt, physical ailments, couldn't see my kids, nothing. All I had a decision, am I going to bleed, or am I going to live? The Bible says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, your darkest valley sometimes is not your addiction. Your darkest valley is a passion you get forward. You walk through, thanks brother, one clap, that was good. Camp in your misery and your self-pity. That Jesus Christ is who Jesus Christ is. And if you continue to grow through it, you walk through it, you fear no evil, fear the false evidence, you fear the real, I can tell you he's done everything I took. He's done everything he told me he would do for me. He doesn't play favorites, he will do it for you. The question is when he puts you to God. I mean, I put you to God because I'm a hit. Now he's saying this, so I hear, you know, Rodney said, Rodney said it's guiding, stretching, and stretching. First Peter, leading over fears. I cast my anxiety because I didn't believe that Jesus cared for me. I mean, I did that 14 years ago, and I continue to do it. Because the devil is an enemy. He wants to kill me. He wants to make me believe. Matthew 6, leading over unmet needs. Some of you are leading over unmet needs. You go and try to get everything back that you lost. I got to go be two for that. I got to go make money. You ran from it to begin with. Stay put, get to know Jesus, push through the crowd, and grab onto his cloak. That's all you need to do. And if you do that, you can have exactly what they have. But we say, I gotta go do this. God says this, put me first. Now, if you put God first, you'll live differently. And that's what God is saying. But people that are bleeding, their thoughts are dominated. People that are bleeding, it's just bleeding over depression. I am bipolar. If you haven't noticed. I take medication. I'm not ashamed of it. For my anxiety. All these years later. I know what it's like to sleep at night now. But that leaning over depression, don't get seen. Take what God afforded you have. Talk about your depression. Don't stay depressed. I'm clinically depressed. How can I live the life I'm living? I couldn't have lived it without Jesus. He handled it for me. Check out Psalm 139. Leaning over low self-worth. I don't like the way I look. I don't like the way we feel. I mean, just grieving, Philippians 2:3, grieving over selfishness. Conceited, empty conceit, arrogant, self-righteous. Arrogant people are just full of fear. Check this out, James 3, pleading over envy. If you're envious of someone else, you're really just confused because you don't understand how they got what they got. You're not willing to do the work that they did to get it. That's envy. And envy, the root of it is confusion. And it's an assumption. Ephesians 4:29, bleeding over negative feelings. The Bible says, do not let an altar talk your mind and mouth. Bleeding with negativity. Oh, I'm so crazy. I'm so crazy. I studied a lot for this, so it's a reason. I'm working on it a little bit longer. Looking at what's wrong versus what's right. Looking at the differences versus the similarities. Looking at the problem versus the solution. You know what I don't often talk to my other colleagues, right? But only what is helpful. Too many of us are just only hurtful. Only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. How do you find out their needs? Well, you've got to listen. Let it make benefit those who listen. People are listening to how you talk. I don't hire people in my company that complain about their own company because I know it's just a matter of time before they complain about me. I don't want people at this church or anywhere that are saying, well, the big thing sucks. You can't understand. Well, the big thing sucks. Hey, it doesn't work. We can work here. So, tonight, if Jesus is your last resort, and you come here with a piece of your family, bleeding with resentment. If you don't forgive, we're the type of people that expect everybody to forgive us, but we won't forgive anybody. God says in His Word, if you don't forgive, and you nurture your hurt and your anger with your deeds, this results in interfering with your relationship with God. Then God will not forgive you. So where are you at with this bleeding? Proverbs 23. If you do not stop bleeding, you will relapse. Who has woe? Bleeding. Sorrow? Bleeding. Strife? Bleeding. Complaint? Bleeding. I mean, complaining about our egos. I mean, we forget that our mental history is a good thing. My current score is a -2. And my criminal history could mean getting a property account. Complaining. I saw a bunch of men and women in our suit today that weren't complaining, playing violence. Sometimes we forget where we came from. I guarantee you, if I was walking back into that coming jail right now, they would all come with me. So, since you're here, stop bleeding. Who has needless bruises about this? Who has bloodshot eyes? Here it is. Those who linger, listen now, if you don't stop bleeding, you're going to go back to the judge and go, oh, don't do those who linger on the line who get sample bowls for the next line. I want to talk to you more about bleeding in your recovery. I'm going to take a sample of self-pity. I'm going to take a sample of judgment. I'm going to take a sample of criticism. I'm going to take a sample of, you know, there's something comfortable about my self-pity. There's something comfortable about my anger, resentment, gossip, and criticism. But when you look at alcohol or drugs, it says they take stamp out of the garbage can. Do not gaze at wine when it's red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it goes down smoothly. In the end, it bites like a snake. It poisons like a viper. Your eyes will see strange sights, and your mind will imagine confusing things. If you're under the influence, this is what happens. If you're emotionally bleeding in your recovery, you're going to see strange sights. You're going to imagine confusing things. You will say, with the one sleeping on the high seas, lying on top of the rain, they hit me, you will say, but I'm not hurt. They beat me, but I don't feel it. When I wake up, so can I find another dream. Alleviating your bleeding doesn't happen when you use your job. With Jesus Christ, He will alleviate your bleeding. Ephesians 2 says your bleeding keeps you far away from Jesus. See, when we weren't sober, we meditated our bleeding with alcohol, drugs, sex, gambling, crime. but now you don't have that meditation, so you're being still with nothing to know. It says, now that Jesus is far away, you are brought near by the Lord Christ. Revelation 12:11. You prevent future bleeding by helping others. You overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Jesus, what Jesus did for you in the word of the testimony. My mind, my life aligns with the word of God. My testimony is his word. My testimony is Romans 8:28. And God works all things together. He took my bad, he took my not so good, he took my good, he took my great. He worked them all together for the good. And I learned how to love him, and I'm a man of purpose. I said, oh, it's important, but I'm extremely confident with that I am walking in the purpose that God has over my life. And when you walk in the purpose that God has over your life, you learn to love God, you learn to love yourself, and you learn to love hundreds of other people. Because at the end of the day, you're walking with the love of Jesus. And I will close with this. Romans 8 says, it's time to overcome the things that make you bleed. Know that all these things that make you bleed in your recovery, we are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. And at the end of the day, I'm here to tell you this. I'm a total love, I'm a black God. I'm telling the sixth person in the room, my thoughts are crazy, but my perception is getting high and over. Christ, my perception will come back. So it's not just about that, but I'm here to tell you this. If God did it for me, God can do it for you. You are more than conquerors for those who, for God is with you. Here's what I'll close with. If you want to get to know who Jesus is, stick around. And I have your own calls today. If you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior tonight, I want you to come to the front after the meeting's over. We will do that with you. Okay, I'm going to close the day. Just let God love that.